I'd like to introduce to you your email mate, our project manager for this conference, Mr. Alan Yu, who is our project manager. So, he and the rest of his team have been responsible for meeting at the airport and all the logistical arrangements for the conference. If you have any logistical needs, please feel free to get in touch with Alan. His number is in the kit that we gave you. There's also conference secretariat. The conference secretariat is set up right outside this hall. The rest of our conference will be held in this room. So anything we can do to make your stay more pleasant, please feel free to contact Alan, our conference secretariat, which is right outside this hall.
Good morning again, and welcome to Escalera Hall. Escalera Hall will be the venue of the rest of the conference, and it's the name that's easy to remember. It sounds like scholar. To make a plenary presentation on the social responsibility of Jesuit business schools, the Ateneo de Manila Response will be the president of the Ateneo de Manila University, Father Bienvenido F. Nerves, Society of Jesus. Father Nerves.
Good morning to all of you. I think in the 20 minutes given me, what I'll have to do is basically kind of an outline. But what I share with you are talks I have given to larger communities about the framework that we do use for the themes that Rudy presented yesterday, excellence, spirituality, and building the nation, or leadership and service. So, let me go to this. I think the context that we face as universities is we are faced with international competitive rankings, and we know that there are no particularly strong points for corporate social responsibility in them. Shanghai Jiao Tong just announced a number of ISI publications or Community Nobel Prize winners and your faculty. And yet, at the same time, we know that as Jesuit universities, we are always called to the common good through our graduates and direct engagement with society.
Sir,
in fact, in the last half of the 20th century, that was the main thing, is to prepare leaders for the common good. But for us as Jesuit universities in particular, we have this particular challenge because Father Arupe, very, very strong words, asked how we are educating our graduates for justice. So it's not the same metric. And blending the two metrics together, the metrics of international competitiveness, which rankings ask, and the metric of forming men and women for others and doing contributing to the common good, is a framework and a challenge we all face. There will be other talks, so I will have to go through details with you. Albert Benriaje, Dean of our Academic Graduate School of Business, will be speaking again in a panel on how we handle corporate social responsibility. Mr. Rico Gonzalez, the director for our Center for Social Entrepreneurship, will also speak on what we do in this area. And Mr. Tony Maloto, the biggest project for the poor in the Philippines, NGO project of building homes and communities, will speak to you, much larger than Habitat so on, and very engaged with the poorest of the poor, and we work very extensively with them. I'll mention them, but I won't go into detail because there's no time. I hope that you attend their talks and they can give you a lot more detail. So what I want to share more with you is kind of the context and the thinking behind our strategy at the Ateneo de Manila to respond to our call to social responsibility. What does it mean in practice? In practice for us, it has evolved for me anyway, others, is that among the various challenges that Dr. Escudero presented for sustainability, the single biggest challenge for us is poverty. And that is our dominant framework, the reality of overwhelming poverty. The reality is that over the last decades, our neighbors have made significant progress in addressing poverty, Indonesia, Thailand, but the Philippines sadly has not. There were articles in the Business World just very recently talking about Millennium Development Goals, and the number one Millennium Development Goal of eradicating extreme poverty, we have that too. So that is for us the single biggest, more important thing. The other thing is we have learned that while the goals of Jesuit education of forming men and women for others is very important, that it is not enough to educate individuals. We eventually have learned that social transformation demands that we have to be willing to engage key institutions, the key institutions that really make a difference in society. Or another way of putting it is that the individuals eventually have to build or reform social institutions. I was engaged in these things as dean of the college here in the 1970s. When I came, I was provincial in the 1980s, so when I came back in 1993 and we had our strategic planning workshop, I articulated our vision mission, and this has been the way we have thought for the last 16 years, as closing two gaps. Our mission, I said, is we have to close two gaps. The first is the competitiveness gap. We live in a very competitive region. China, Japan, Korea, Singapore, some of the fastest growing economies are around us. And some of the best educational systems are around us. If you look at the rankings of universities in the world, some of the very best are in our region. So we live in a very competitive region in terms of economics, business, in terms as well as education. So we have to work to compete in that area. But equally important is we have to close the gap between the rich at the top of the social pyramid and the majority poor at the bottom of the pyramid in the Philippines. After many years of working on this problem, we realized that the biggest problem we face is the gap in education, culture, resources, even worldview between those few at the top, relatively few at the top, and those at the bottom of the pyramid. And we have to find a way to close that gap. In the 1970s, we tried to close the gap by a strategy of, on the one hand, organizing communities of the poor at the grassroots. We are very engaged in that. And many of the leading NGOs in the Philippines came from the formation programs we had in the 1970s. And we also saw that we could engage and conscientize leaders at the top, and there's been some success in that. However, we realized after 10, 12, 15 years that organizing at the community level, the NGO level, was too small scale. It was not ultimately sustainable. They were always dependent on inputs from grants and so forth. They could not mainstream. They were too small scale. And we also realized that advocacy at the top with individuals would not work because you had to make middle-level institutions, social welfare institutions, banks, and so forth, they had to be able to respond. You had to engage in what we call the JDIM institutions. The other thing we realize more and more is the Philippines is a very fragmented country. We are fragmented by geography, seas, rivers, mountains. We are fragmented by languages. We have about 12 major language groups and 80 major languages in the Philippines, cultures. And so therefore, there are no easy solutions from the top. You have, as our dean of the School of Government says, you have to think of development in the Philippines as a mosaic of small towns and cities and put them together. And so actually, one of the key initiatives we have, and although this is a meeting about business schools, this is quite key for us, because actually our Ateneo Graduate School of Business that gave birth to, but first a project of managing local governments. We established an Ateneo School of Government about a dozen years ago, and specific mandate is to work with local governments. Because it is, we believe that the municipality or the city is the correct size. It's not the whole country, it's bigger than a community, and it can be made sustainable. In other words, you can actually make development sustainable at a town level or a city level, which you cannot do at a small community level. And very key, even for business, is the role of the local government. The mayors. So that's a framework of the liberty. Okay, I think I can move to it. I would like to give you this, since we have a short period, I just give you an example of a couple of initiatives of engaging poverty and maybe use it as a way of explaining what we have learned of what works. It applies to many others. One of them is actually taking the poorest of the poor, building homes and communities for them, but eventually finding out how can they get sustainable, how do you develop businesses for them. And the second is a lesson we have learned about the importance of health and the key role that health, health management, health finance can play in working for the poor. Okay, so we have to shift to a different slide. So this is the work with a group called Dawal Kalinga. It's a work that actually I presented part of this talk at a global summit in Singapore last month, but this is a version for you. Okay. Sorry. Dawal Kalinga means translated into English is a kind of giving hope, offering of care. Dawal is offering, Kalinga is care. It's a project started about 10 years ago to build homes, families, and communities for the poor. And we, Ateneo de Manila is actually the main partner from the very beginning and up to now. I'll just tell you the story of the first village we built. We built this in 2003. And it's maybe an example of what we have learned about what it takes to take a very poor community and bring them to sustainability, as we talk about it. Okay. So this is what it looked like when we started there in 2003. Homes were just, they just put cardboard or that type of things together. This is what it looked like in 2004. One of the most interesting things we found is that these are urban poor communities and they have a lot of distrust of people going in and exploited so much. And one of the most interesting experiences we had is that the point at which they began to trust us was when we built these pavers. And the children finally could play not in the mud. When they saw their children playing on a clean surface, they turned around and began to welcome us. Sometimes you never know what's the turning point in engaging people and winning their trust. Our students have been involved from the very beginning. These are art design students. We challenge them from the very beginning to make the place as beautiful as possible. The homes are very small, it's 20 square meters, and the space is very limited, but how to make it beautiful and livable is a key thing. Everything we learn here is that color is very, very important. When you look at poor communities in the Philippines, the colors are gray and brown. And we found out that it makes a big difference if people wake up to bright colors. So many lessons that you never think about in our lives, but you learn as you work with the poor. And well, since this is a business conference, we had to talk immediately about business for them. How can you create livelihoods for them? And in fact, some of our young graduates about several years ago actually started what they call the Social Entrepreneurship Challenge. And they asked these student organizations to find out what kind of businesses can you develop for the people. So they went there, they found out that many of the people were good cooks, so they said they'll develop a catering service. Which they did, and these are the women.